Good morning, everybody. Just super grateful to be able to bring God's word to you today. We're going to be talking about multiplication by imitation. So I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Acts chapter 9. Imitation has actually been a theme in our household the last few months. As most of you know, we have a almost 18-month-old son, Judah, and over the last 4 or 5 months, he's really started to soak up some of the things that we're doing, and he's been imitating us a lot. And it's kind of been humbling for us, but also really exciting. Some of the things that I love basketball. I love watching sports. So anytime we turn on a game, he's so excited. Oh, ball. And then I didn't notice it till recently, but usually when I'm watching a game, I'll end up picking up one of the balls that he has for his little tykes, and I'll start shooting during said game. And he starts to do that now. He does this little squat thing that I cannot do. I don't know where he learned that one from. But he imitates me in that way. He also does some things that maybe I don't want to be imitated. I've noticed during, again, said games, that I might be a little critical of missed shots or someone that drops a pass, and I'll be like, oh, boo, come on, catch the ball. So when I picked up one of his little tykes balls and I shot a shot the other day, he was like, ah, boo. I didn't make it. So he picks up some of those things. He imitates me in those ways. Another way that he imitates us, again, that I'm a little proud of, but again, I should probably tone it back, is our dogs think that they are securing Fort Knox at our apartment. So whenever someone closes a door outside, they run all the way up to the door full speed, sometimes not being able to stop in time hitting the door. And I usually yell, Molly, champ, stop. You're so annoying. And the other day, the dogs, again, I think someone breathed in the hallway, so the dogs ran up there. And I see Judah running over, stop, no! I'm like, good job, buddy, but maybe let's tone it down a little. So this idea of imitation is something that Judah is picking up from us, and we pick up from others. And we're gonna read that Peter picks up from Jesus, and subsequently we should pick up from the people around us that follow God and that imitate Christ, and that we should also pick up from Christ and his word. So let's open Acts chapter 9. We're gonna actually start in verse 31. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. Now as Peter went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived in Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. And immediately he rose, and all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Verse 36, now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. She was full of good works and acts of charity. In those days she became ill and died, and when they had washed her and laid her in the upper room, since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. So Peter rose and went with them. When he arrived, they took him to the upper room. All the widows stood beside him weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. But Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes. And when she saw Peter, she sat up. And he gave her his hand and raised her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he presented her alive. And it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. And he stayed in Joppa many days with one, Simon a tanner. So we're talking about this idea of multiplication through imitation, and a little roadmap for you. We're going to talk about going to those who need us, and we're going to have three subpoints to that, which will be Build and be built up. Never be too busy to see the need and glorify God through his grace. And then we're also going to hit on do exactly what Jesus did. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, please speak through me. Please allow hearts and minds to be open to your word and not my words. Lord, we ask that you would meet us here in this place and you'd speak into specific lives and that you would, Lord, you would continue to build us up as your church, as your body. Lord, I give you thanks for this congregation. I give you thanks for the ability to worship. And I just pray that your will would be done this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So going to those who need you. Let's build and be built up. So Peter is going to the church that are results of the persecution that happened. So if we remember all the way back to Acts chapter 8, verse 1, this is right after the stoning of Stephen. The church is actually scattered throughout Judea and Samaria, and it's because of the persecution that they face. So these disciples that Peter is now going to, that he is now called in verse 31 to go and build them up, these are most likely people that he's never met. These are results of disciples going out and proclaiming the good news during that scattering, during that persecution. And Peter is called and as an apostle, and we're also called as disciples to build people up and build one another up. So again, in verse 31, so the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up. And walking in the fear of the Lord and comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. So then in verse 32, now Peter went here and there among them as a saint to the saints. So Peter's going and he's going to encourage. We see in Hebrews 3:13, be encouraged but encourage one another day after day, as long as it is called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sins. This idea of building up is seen throughout all of the New Testament. Most of the epistles are letters to churches building them up. And building them up doesn't always mean, oh, you're doing a great job, you're like, way to go, keep going. Sometimes building up also means correction. So we can assume that Peter's going and saying, hey, it's great that you guys have come to know Christ. Let me tell you more about how you can be better followers or better imitators of Christ. So Peter is going there, and he's speaking into the lives of these people. I felt led as I was reading this passage to, now that I get to have all of you in this room and I have a microphone, I want to build all of you up. I've been, and Steph has been, so blessed by each and every one of you that call this church your home. We have been overwhelmed and amazed by just the care and the love that you guys show for one another and you show for us and our family. You guys are doing a great job living on mission. We're seeing more people joining groups and being in community. I think it's a testament. People are bringing food to share with others today for Friendsgiving. That is such an encouragement. Continue on and walking in that. I also really care deeply for you, and I'm a realist. Stephanie actually gets mad at me when we watch movies because even if one scene is kind of unrealistic, I'm like, that movie was not good. It just didn't make any sense. That was so unrealistic. So as a realist, which is why I love Forrest Gump, because everything in that movie is so realistic. As a realist, I know that we all will not be in the same church family as we grow older. Like, there will be some people that move out of the city, there will be some people that take other jobs, and we will not all always be in this community of church. But I want to encourage you, and I want to implore you, even if there will be times, if you stay here long enough, that I will probably offend you or hurt you or not meet your expectations. There will be other Christians in this church and in other churches that will not always meet your expectations. But I want to encourage you, I want to implore you to stay in the faith, Jesus will never let you down. The words of this Bible ring true. Every day, all day. So stay, I want to encourage you to stay in the faith. Always stay in the faith. Always trust in God, even in the hardest of circumstances. Always trust in God. Okay, so going to those who need you also includes never being too busy to see the need. We see this in the text right here as Peter is going here and there. So Peter's mission, let's just look at it like this. Peter's mission is to, okay, I'm going to go to these churches. I'm going to build these people up. On the way there, he sees Aeneas. That Aeneas was not his mission. His mission was, okay, I'm going to go to these churches, build them up. But on the way, he sees a need. He sees Aeneas, who's bedridden for 8 years, who is paralyzed. And he says, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. Aeneas wasn't the end goal of this journey, right? He was a portion of it. He was somebody that was there, that he saw a need, and he was like, Jesus Christ heals you. So the healing was not the end goal. We see this throughout most of Jesus' ministry throughout the Gospels, right? Matthew 14 is a great example of Jesus is going to a desolate place. This is immediately after he finds out that John the Baptist has died. So his cousin, good friend, someone that baptized Jesus has died. So he's like, I'm going to go to a desolate place, most likely to mourn, most likely to pray. And as he gets off the boat, as he's going to this place, there's a huge crowd gathered. And the scriptures say that Jesus had compassion on them. So he stayed with them. Jesus's goal, his end goal of that day was to go to this desolate place and pray and mourn and be alone. But he saw this multitude of people that needed him, and he had compassion on them. And as the story goes on, he teaches them. But then another need arises, and they're all hungry, and they don't have any food. So the disciples are like, well, we don't got any money, so just send them away. And Jesus says, well, collect what you have. And that's the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. But Jesus saw the need. He saw the need on the way to the mission. There's actually a practical implication, probably in most of your lives in this, but I'm going to call out a couple that's in our church. Kendall and JT actually had something happen like this about a month ago. They were hanging out. I think they were watching a football game with another couple, and they ordered a pizza. I'm pretty sure they didn't want to pay the delivery fee, so they walked to get the pizza. And on the way, so their mission, right, is, okay, we're hanging out with these people. It's halftime. I want to watch the game. My mission is to go pick up the pizza and come back. But they ended up finding a girl that was actually not in good shape, and she was actually passed out on the street. And they could have been like everyone else that day, or that hour, that probably walked past her and were like, oh, well, she made some poor life decisions today. But they saw the need on the way to their mission. And they went, and they actually got her up and asked her where she was going and if she had the means to get home. So they actually ended up paying for an Uber for her. And the story gets better. They actually ended up praying for her and exchanging numbers and talking and sharing the gospel with this girl. How easy could it have been to just, okay, well, that's not my problem. I'm going to go get my pizza and come back home. They saw the need. Let us never be, we all live busy lives. I think that's the number one excuse that we all get when we're trying to meet up with someone. I'm busy. Oh, how was your week? I was busy. We all live busy lives. But let's never be too busy to see that need. And going to those who need you also means glorifying God through his grace. So we see in this story, we see two separate miracles, right? We talked about the first one and the paralyzed man. And then we also see Dorcas restored to life, and we're going to get a little bit more into that later. But I want to mention that when we see miracles in the Bible, and maybe you haven't seen a miraculous thing like a paralyzed man just get up and take his bed and walk in your life, or maybe you've never witnessed somebody be raised from the dead, I think we can kind of be pushed out into being like, oh, well, that doesn't happen. If God did that, then I would have faith. Well, of course, if God was working that power through me, then I would have faith. But I also wanted to encourage us that sometimes the purpose of the miracles is to authenticate the gospel message. Sometimes the purpose of these miracles is to authenticate the gospel message. We do see that Jesus heals the paralyzed person, but note in verse 35, and all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Yes, Aeneas was blessed by this extreme miracle. But what was the result of that? It was all of the residents of Lydda and Sharon turning to the Lord. We can probably rightly assume that when the gospel spread through that persecution, that these people heard about Jesus, most of the residents, or they knew somebody that had come to Christ. But they didn't believe until the authentication came of the gospel. We see in Isaiah 35, verses 5 and 6 and then 10. Then the eyes of the blind shall be open and the ears of the deaf unstopped. And then shall the lame man leap like a deer. Oh, what great imagery. And the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. We see that in this scripture and in our story, the purpose of the miracle, yes, it was a great thing for Aeneas, but we see that this everlasting joy comes from these miracles. This authentication of this gospel message comes from these miracles. There's actually a modern-day miracle that I have the privilege of sharing with you guys. So actually my aunt Kim was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer in October of 2020. The prognosis was pretty grim, and it was a very difficult and sad time for our family, just kind of navigating through that. And then through the grace of God and through hours and hours of prayer from our family and friends, she actually started to the treatment started to work, and tumors started to shrink, and prognosis was looking up, and it was a time of rejoicing. And then as she was going for a scan in November of 2021 to check out how the treatment was working, they actually found stage 4 colon cancer. So you get this initial blow, and it's just devastating, right? And then you see God work, and you're like, oh God, you're using this treatment, you're giving wisdom to these doctors. Like, this is great. And then you're hit with another boulder, right? And how do you glorify God through that? How do you look to God and, like, how do you glorify God through that? I want to share a text that she sent. So that she got diagnosed in November 2021, so about a year ago. She sent a text to my mom, who forwarded it to our family group chat the other day. And it read, EKG was normal. Blood work looks good, I am told, for someone having treatments. Platelets were back up, hemoglobin holding steady, other liver enzymes looking good. The tumor marker, which had been 25.9 3 weeks ago, is back down to 15. I see the colon oncologist on Wednesday morning. Lots of answered prayer today. Much praise due to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And praise God, right? And if that was the end of the text, it would be like, yes, glory to God, he is working. But God always uses these moments when we have faith and we trust in him to advance his gospel message, to give glory to him through his grace. She continued, "It was exciting today when I had the EKG and the text said it was normal." She told me her uncle was diagnosed with colon cancer and has liver lesions, which was pretty much the exact same diagnosis as my aunt had. I briefly told her my story, and the technician said, "Well, Christmas is coming, so we should look for a miracle." And my aunt said, "Well, I told her that Jesus is performing miracles every day." And she pondered on it a bit. So my prayer is that God would provide a believer in her life. 2020 diagnosis, 2020 diagnosis, very grim. 2021 diagnosis, like, God, what are you doing? Opportunity to share the gospel in 2022. Like, how great is our God? How much should we glorify him through that? She would have never got the chance to speak into this woman's life if she hadn't gone through all of those things. And that's not to say that the treatment and some of the days are very difficult. But we should always, always have the mindset of glorifying God, because he is continually giving us grace. Okay. Now we're going to jump into, let's do exactly what Jesus did. What do I mean by that? So we see, we're going to see some mirror passages. So Luke is the author of Acts, and he's also the author of the Gospel of Luke. And it is not by any mistake that these stories have basically mirroring stories in the book of Luke and the book of Acts. So we're going to pull up these mirroring stories. So we read the one in Acts. So in Luke 5:24, the Pharisees here are like, "Who are you to say you can forgive sins? Yeah, that's blasphemy." And Jesus basically is saying, "Okay, well, what's easier, for me to say that I can forgive sins or for me to tell this man to get up and walk?" And we see this language, and he said to the man who was paralyzed, "I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home." And then going on all the way to the end, "And they glorified God and were filled with awe, saying, we have seen extraordinary things today." Peter did he basically said the exact same words that Jesus said. He witnessed these things and then said the exact same words. He imitated Jesus. He did exactly as Jesus did. And then we see also in this story where he raises Tabitha to life. We see this same story as Jairus, one of the synagogue leaders, calls to Jesus after his daughter had fallen ill. And we see that in that story, throughout it, actually Jairus' daughter ends up dying. And Jesus is on his way, and to kind of bounce back to another point, this is when he heals the woman that's been having discharge for 12 years. So Jesus was seeing the need always. He was never too busy, even on his way to go resurrect this girl. And we see pretty much the exact mirror, except for in the story in Luke, they were pleading with him to come to the house. They pled for Peter. But we see in this story in Luke that Jesus, it was kind of this foreknowledge that Peter would be in this position. So he only brings in the three disciples that he was closest with. Peter, James, and John join him in this room, along with the parents of the girl. And he goes by the girl's bedside and he says, "My child, get up." And then we see Peter. The only difference is in the story is Peter's like, "Okay, everybody leave. I need to be alone. I hope this works. All right, I'm going to pray." No, Peter had faith, right? Peter had seen it be done before, and he saw the power that Jesus had. And what he said is, "Tabitha, get up." It's the exact same language that Jesus used. We need to do exactly what Jesus did. So how do we do that? We have these commandments from Jesus. We have the word of God that always holds true. We have these commandments. The end of the Great Commission, Jesus in Matthew 28, verse 20, he says, "Teach them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you to the end of the age." And in John 15, this is the famous passage in John where Jesus is talking about he is the vine and we are the branches and we are to abide in him. Verse 10, he says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you that my joy may be filled and that your joy may be full. Jesus gave us these commandments, and he gave us his word to obey. And it's so interesting in this passage in John, we are to abide in love. So what does keeping commandments mean? It brings forth love, and it brings forth joy. So if you hear, "Oh, obey Jesus' commandments and keep my commandments," and you kind of feel like this weight coming down upon you of maybe legalism, or, "Well, what if I don't want to do that?" Following the commandments and listening to the commandments and obeying Jesus should bring forth joy, and it should bring forth love. We should be joyful in obeying the commands of Jesus. We should be joyful in imitating Jesus in all things, because it shows love. The famous passage in Micah 6:8, "He has told you, O man, what is it good? What is good? And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and walk humbly with your God?" Obeying God is not a legalistic or authoritarian way of living. It's a way of doing justice and loving one another, having compassion on one another. Following the commands of God is walking humbly. It's not, "Oh, I know more than you," or, "Oh, I'm more righteous than this person." That should never creep into our mind when we have knowledge of a situation. We should be walking alongside of others, following the commands of our Lord and Savior, because it brings on joy and it brings on love. So I have two questions for us as we're starting to wrap up our time. What is something that you need to get rid of in your life that will make you a better imitator of Christ? What is something that you need to get rid of in your life that will make you a better imitator of Christ? We all have something that might hinder our witness. Here's a good indicator. If you have a group of non-Christian friends and you act exactly the same as them, there might be a few things that you need to get rid of in your life so it won't damage your witness. What are some of those things? Is it your language? Is it how you make jokes? Is it a sin pattern in your life? Maybe when you're alone, that is hindering your relationships. What do you need to get rid of to make you a better imitator of Christ? The good thing is that we don't have to do that alone. We don't have to search ourselves alone. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24, it says, the psalmist is saying, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." God will help us sift through these things. The Holy Spirit is there. He's called the helper to sift through these things in our life. So what do you need to get rid of to be a better imitator of Christ? And who are you imitating that is imitating Jesus? We see Paul use this in a lot of his letters, right? He says, imitate me as I of Christ in 1 Corinthians 11:1. And in Philippians 3:17, he says, join one another in following my example, brothers, and carefully observe those who walk according to the pattern set for you. Paul uses this language, imitate me as I imitate Christ. So we have to get rid of some of the stuff we have to get rid of to be better witnesses, but we also have to invite people along as we're following Christ, as we're imitating him, as we're being imitators of him. Jesus set the example, and we have all that we need in his word. We have all that we need through prayer. But we should be imitating Jesus so that others can imitate our posture. So Peter, we see that he imitated Jesus pretty much verbatim in these verses. But Peter's life was also an imitation of Christ. That doesn't mean Peter didn't make mistakes. It doesn't mean Peter didn't mess up in ways. But he imitated Christ, and he even imitated him in healing. And the last thing that I'll leave us with is Peter did do these healings, and these are miraculous things, and God is still doing these works. But I do want to remind us that Aeneas and Tabitha, they were healed in this moment, and many people came to Christ. And we might be like, God, why can't you do that in my life? God, why, Lord, my aunt, my uncle, my brother, my cousin, why can't you just do this miraculous thing? And I do want to remind us that even in the midst of those times, that we should be reminded that Aeneas, he's not still living today. He lived his life and he ended up dying. Tabitha got renewed life and she ended up dying again. But there was one that ended up dying for your sins and for my sins. And when Jesus was raised again, he didn't die again. Jesus is still alive. He is still reigning. He is still who we should be going after. He is the one that we should be imitating. So as we desire these things in our hearts and our minds, and we desire for those that we love to be healed or restored, let's remember, let's have an eternal mindset. Let's have this eternal mindset of we need to follow Christ, and the good news is that he is alive. He was raised on that third day after dying for all of our sins. So let's point people to that. Let's imitate that Christ. Let's imitate that Lord. Let him be the Lord of our lives. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I'm grateful that you have given us your word, that you have given us a gathering place. Lord, I pray that as we go about our weeks and months ahead, that you would remind us to be imitators of you, that you would place people in our lives, and that you would place ourselves in situations that we can imitate you and be your witnesses here, because you call us to be co-laborers with you. Jesus, the fact is that the most important thing is to point people to eternal life. This life will fade. Our bodies will wither. But you never will. You are the beginning and the end. The eternal one. The one who reigns forever. The one who is worthy of our praise. The one who is worthy to be sung. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And Lord, we want to imitate you. So let it be so in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.